Hey guys, this is Sarah's Night, and I decided to try a little Bioshock 2 today. This is actually one of my all-time favorites in survival horror. I don't know if you can really call Bioshock horror. It does have its elements, but probably more accurately described as a first-person shooter, more about action than horror. But anyway, it's actually a really good game. I was pleasantly surprised by how much I enjoyed the sequel of Bioshock, even though it really is kind of Bioshock 1 all over again. But hey, more of a good thing, right? So what I'm going to try to do here on this run-through, even though it's been a few years, is go through on hard mode and just try to die as few times as possible. So for those of you who don't know, while you're watching the introduction scene here, Bioshock is, or the entire series, I mean, it's about this, kind of like this really archaic city that was built underwater by this rich and powerful guy named Andrew Ryan, who, I don't know, he's pretty much like embraces anarchy, so he wanted to go his own way. He didn't like the way, you know, most of society in the upper world governed itself, all that kind of stuff. Wanted a dream city of his own where people were free to do whatever the hell they wanted. So, you know, he made that dream happen by putting this city underwater where it would hardly be known, its existence would hardly be known by anybody, and only his, you know, closest friends, associates, business partners, all those kind of people were invited to come and start the city with him. But you'll quickly learn, and you know, as you play through the first Bioshock game, that naturally that did not go over well. War breaks out. Especially, you know, it was the main thing about his system of business in this whole city was just that entirely free market, no regulations whatsoever. So of course, you know, people using their greatest inventions, they come to blows over power. Money. I'm not really describing this well, I know. But hopefully you get what I'm trying to say. And internal strife, civil war breaks out, ruins the city. And what's left of it is these guys right here who you see. Not to mention the person from the player's perspective right now. Big Daddies and Splicers. These Splicer guys are insane. They're always trying to capture these little girls whose genes were altered by science. I don't really know how to say it. Trying to steal this precious substance in them called Adam, which is basically like, it's like techno magic. Adam is what gives people their powers through science, but you know, the powers are like all mystical in nature. You know, you throw in fireballs and electricity, ice out of your hands, all that stuff.
Do you understand? Her name is Eleanor.
I know it probably would have been beneficial for me to have gone through now, the first game for those of you who were in my audience who have never played Bioshock before, so you can get a good idea of what's going on. But I don't know, I actually like Bioshock 2 even better, and I kind of wanted to get right to that.
Now, take the pistol.
But anyway, what's happening in this in this scene is, I think sometime, it's going to take place sometime after the events of Bioshock, even though in this introductory scene, it's actually like 10 years earlier. So you've got this particular Big Daddy who you're going to be playing as in the game called Subject Delta. That's his name. I mean, simply Delta. Big Daddies were not, you know, when they were created from real human beings and like surgically fitted into these gigantic armored diving suits in order to protect the little sisters running around. They weren't exactly graced with human-like qualities, like actually having their own unique name, just a series of Greek letters. But you actually, as Subject Delta, you formed a particular bond with this one little sister named Eleanor, and that was her mother just now who convinced you to commit suicide. And here, 10 years later, think a little bit after the events of Bioshock 1, even though the character you're playing as, Subject Delta right now, has no affiliation, as far as I know, with the person you play as in Bioshock 1. So this is just like an alternate story, alternate conflict going on in Rapture, in the city of Rapture at the same time. I mean, there's a lot of little stories that kind of make up this place. So, one thing I really did actually not like about the Bioshock games is this Vita chamber. It's kind of, it's the plot device used to explain why you're able, you know, if you ever die in the game, why you're able to just come right back, you know, instead of going back to the save point. I mean, the last time you saved, anything like that, you're pretty much right on the scene where you left off. And it's because of these things. They were an invention in Rapture at some point before it went nuts. Where it's like, you put a dead person in there, or a person on the fringe of death, and this like somehow hastily like reconstructs, you know, their body, no matter what happened to that body, in order to cause death, in order to just totally bring them back to life, get your heart beating again, your vital organs are put back in place, your blood starts flowing, and somehow all with the power of science. I mean, this is basically right here what Jesus can do. And you can do it as many times as you want. So yeah, first person perspective from Subject Delta here. Right now, it's going to look like there's not much going on. And it probably... You probably have to kind of be like me in order to really get into the atmosphere at first. At first, when I first played through this game, right after it first came out, I remember I got on Xbox Live with Lantis, and we just kind of started playing together, you know, from our, you know, each playing the game separately, but kind of getting each other's firsthand impressions right then and there over audio. And I didn't tell him at the time, but I was thinking how odd it was. Whoops. How do you crouch again? Ah, left button. It's showing keyboard controls, but I'm actually playing with an Xbox controller. But first time I was playing through, I just happened to... Somehow I got this impression that this game was a lot more detached when it came to atmosphere and music than the first game, but I was really wrong. Kind of a few years later, after I'd gone through it a few times, I really came to believe that they did a terrific job with getting you into the atmosphere here. Really great job with music. And the dialogue is... I really liked it. This is probably, in terms of like dialogue, I think this is probably my favorite story in all the video games I've ever played. I mean, right now, you know, it's kind of silent, and there's not any enemies, because, especially if this is your first time playing a Bioshock game ever, well, gotta get acquainted with what's going on first. Oh, Splicer. Of course, combat's gonna be pretty simple starting out. Enemies aren't gonna be able to do much damage to you, even on hard mode. Okay, what was that? 1509? You could see the combination on the door. Oh. 1540. My bad. In fact, I think it was right there, because I looked at it, so... the code was... actually showing up on screen right there, because it's like, the game recognizes that you, as the character, actually saw it, so there's no reason for you to have to guess what it was. So, 10 years later, a bunch of the other little sisters, I don't know, somehow managed to drag your body, even though you're practically gargantuan in comparison to the average human being when you're a big daddy. And they dragged you over to a Vita chamber and revived you. Now, quite frankly, the villain of our little game, Sophia Lamb, in this picture right here, she kind of should have known that somebody might be willing to do that for you, just bring you back to life with something as simple as, I mean, these Vita chambers are all over the place. And I think they have infinite uses, so did she really think you were gonna stay dead? I mean, if nothing else, would have been kind of nice if she had some of her Splicer lackeys actually, like, take your, you know, drag your body out, you know, outside into the airlock, release you into the ocean. Probably nobody would ever be able to come back out and get you. Or, shoot, put you on a lifeboat of some sort, bring you back up to the surface. Nobody would know what to do with your dead body. They would never be able to figure out who you are, where you came from, likely. So in this game, pretty much the purpose, and I mean, you can summarize it pretty simply, is you're, you know, you've woken up, you're on a quest to rescue Eleanor from Sophia Lamb's custody. Sophia Lamb is actually her real human mother, and you with Subject Delta is just kind of her father in terms of the bond you share, but not by blood.
Daddy was sleeping for such a long time. And Eleanor has missed.
And I like how they designed the little sisters in this game. You can see how, I mean, they're pretty spooky. The yellow eyes and the gaunt, kind of the gaunt face. And the simple, you know, like, cutesy little six-year-old purple dress they're wearing. And they talk in a strange voice. But for those of you who have played this, you know, played a Bioshock game before, you know that, you know, optionally part of what you can do is actually find each of these little sisters in the possession of a Big Daddy. You fight the Big Daddy, who's only trying to protect her because that's all he's programmed to do, and you can take the little sister and somehow save her. I think it was in the first game one of your allies gave you what's called a plasmid. It's what gives you these superhuman abilities right here. You just saw me inject one right here at the Gatherer's Garden. She'll give you a plasmid that you can somehow, you know, don and be able to, just by touching the forehead of the little sisters, like, somehow you've released them from their... for lack of a better term, from their plight. And they're all, like, normal little girls again. So the other little sisters are basically trying to help me on my way to finding Eleanor. Oh. Hi. Oh, kind of forgot. Even a Big Daddy can take big damage from a fall. Alright, I hear another splicer in the room. Really, these splicers in particular, they're either going to be trying... I mean, Adam's like a drug to them, so they're either going to be trying to kill the little sisters off and harvest the Adam from them, or they're in your way because Sophia Lamb sent them to stop you from reaching Eleanor. They're like, working for her. And a lot of the story here is given through what's called audio diaries. You're just going to hear the audio here.
If you feel the soft patter of rain on your hat, you're already fired. Listen to. You can jumpstart a dead generator with a direct spark, but clear the gas.
Oh, okay. Well,
first scares these.
That was our cue.
Watch a working stiff hurling thunderbolts. You follow me?
And that opened up this door over here. At least I think it did. No?
Ah, at last a signal.
Oh, in fact, the woman talking to me now is the one I was just speaking of, who gives you the ability to save little sisters in Bioshock 1. She's also... Tenenbaum is also in this game.
I know who you are, and I am in much need of your help. Please, find me in the Atlantic Express train station.
Oh, and I like you can hear this 30s and 40s music always playing in the background. I guess because, well, that's pretty much the time period in which this game is taking place. But I always enjoyed listening to those songs. It just provides a nice little touch. In fact, the one that's playing right now is one of my favorites from this game, at least in terms of the vocal songs. Daddy, won't you please come home? But yeah, in this city, there's a huge public sound system, speakers wired up everywhere to where you can hear this music piping out all the time, no matter where you are. Sophia Lamb, I never really thought much of her at first at all, but she really is an interesting villain. It's like you can kind of almost sympathize with her way. I mean, basically, she's using Eleanor and all these experiments to kind of... It's like she's trying to turn all the little sisters, especially Eleanor, kind of... just based on these principles of altruism and sort of like the moral good without making the choice for good or evil. Because, you know, on one hand, you might always think as a human being, hey, what if there was no evil in the world because everybody was just sort of made to do good? It's just by their nature. So that it eventually would eliminate all evil on the planet, you know, murder, theft, strife, war, starvation, disease, all that stuff. And that's kind of what she's trying to achieve with Eleanor, but in principle, Big Daddy disagrees.
But here it is, and it's real. Rapture. This is where that thing took my poor baby girl. From what I saw in the sub, most of the city's in ruins. But there were lights here and there, and shapes moving. Ugh, I'm rambling, scared, I guess. But maybe, if I find this Dr. Lamb I keep hearing over the PA, I'll find Cindy too.
And as you can see, in the quest for that altruism, Sophia doesn't mind dirtying her hands a little bit. I'm sure she's responsible for this message and the dead body. Amazing. But of course, what's gonna scare Big Daddy? So for right now, first weapon in the game other than your melee, which you're always going to be able to use no matter what, you don't need ammo for it, your drill arm, we have this thing called a rivet gun. And really, that was one of the things about... That's one of the little things about Bioshock 2 that I really liked. I think you have a total of 7 or 8 different guns throughout the game, and really none of them are useless at all. I mean, of course, some will be better than others, but it's worth investing into pretty much all of them. Okay, so here, I just found the little sister who got taken away by that other creature you saw earlier who, you know, if you could see Subject Delta right now, in a way she would look just like him, but she's called, she's kind of a different breed of Big Daddy called Big Sister. And, you know, she has, like, pretty much a, you know, she has a, like, a more feminine body, even through the diving suit, you can tell, just to kind of give her a distinct appearance from the male Big Daddies. So, we found her now. And just to sort of kick off the introductory stage of the game... The Big Sister is going to attack, and I am just about to lose to her, but... She actually, for some reason, goes away and just sort of leaves me to die instead of finishing me off. But I'm really no match for her right now. I mean, she pretty much needs to have me in, like zero health, where I can't take another hit, even if this were easy mode. Now, if only I remembered how to, there we are, how to use the med kit. Oh, never mind. Actually, I remember her taking away your entire
this
life.
Is Dr. Sophia Lama with a message for the people.
I'll let you listen
remember,
to this first.
Big Sister is always watching. To steal Adam is to steal from the Rapture family. Your family.
I didn't quite remember that little piece of information. Apparently, Sophia is using the Big Sisters to make sure that people don't steal Adam from each other. Because when you do steal Adam, usually requires a bloodletting, I think. So, murder, wrong, I guess. Basically. Oh, but anyway, what I was about to say, In this game, you know, you use med kits pretty standard, to restore your health. And you can see those numbers in the upper left corner. The red bar represents my health. The number to the left of that is how many med kits that I have left in my inventory that I can use before I die. And the purple bar is the amount of Eve that I have, which Eve is kind of like... It's like the amount of magical power that you have to use Adam. I mean, Eve is a manufactured substance too. It's just kind of to keep your drive going in order to be able to use the abilities that you gain with Adam. Adam, Eve, you know, of course, you get the references there. And I'll admit, I have no idea who wrote this message, but it's kind of bizarre. I actually don't think that's, it's kind of something Sophia would write. So here's the little sister again, thinking she's going to kill me, but I'm a big daddy, I can survive underwater. I was designed to breathe underwater. It was a small feature, but unlike in, Bioshock 1, something I really liked about this game was that in between levels, I mean, I kind of separate Rapture, the whole entire place, into certain levels. It's like you go to one area of Rapture that has a distinct name, has a distinct use, and, you know, you'll achieve all your goals there and then go on. And unlike in Bioshock 1, in between the levels of Rapture, you actually get to go outside into the ocean, just kind of get a look around.
Rapture is the death of many great men. Alone, you will not last long. You can still reach the train station. Find me there.
Yeah, and that's where Bridget Tenenbaum is telling me to go, because she wants to help me. You know, you get these short little walking sequences out here in the middle of the ocean before you enter into the airlock that takes you, you know, to the next part of Rapture. And here you see a Big Daddy fighting with some slicers trying to protect his little sister. Somehow, little sisters, they were born with some kind of, you know, immunity to physical trauma of any kind, so that they can totally be caught in this battle, you know, with lasers and rockets and machine guns. You know, whenever the Big Daddy needs to protect them from splicers, and they never get hurt. It's fascinating. It's a really bizarre story, but I mean, a lot of things about this entire game series is very fantastical and bizarre. But nevertheless, I really can't seem to explain it right now. But it's actually one of the most immersive environments and stories that I mean, in all the video games I've ever played in my life. The story is probably its greatest strength to me. But yeah, you get to walk outside in the ocean for a little bit. You don't really interact with anything. It's just kind of more scenic before you step into step through an airlock and, you know, back into the inner city and take on the next stage of the game. Now, luckily, even though you'll kind of hear Subject Delta groan when he lands from up top in the ocean. I mean, when he's in the ocean, it does not do damage to him. He kind of sounds like it's a little bit painful, though, but I guess the water being more dense than air kind of softens the fall. Okay, Atlantic Express, that's where Tenenbaum wanted me to go next. And I just got an achievement called Daddy's Home. I mean, that pretty much means just finish this part of the game. It's like you know, Subject Delta, back from the dead, coming to take what's his, Daddy's Home.
As the little one said you would. Come upstairs to the ticket booth, and I will offer what I know of you.
The one thing I really did not like, though, is when you actually meet Tenenbaum in person here in a little bit, she really plays no part in the rest of the game. It's weird. They kind of make her out to be a character that will definitely stick around. It's not that she dies or anything. She just sort of goes away and leaves you in the care of another person who's on your side and is trying to, you know, his purposes of escaping Rapture sort of align your own. And she leaves you in this new guy's care and then just kind of never shows up again at all for the rest of the game. It's really kind of weird. But I mean, I guess the fact that she didn't leave you alone completely, you know, she just had someone else sort of take over. I mean, I guess that kind of makes up for how little sense it would normally make if she just left totally and you're on your own the rest of the game.
Now most who survive are like this. Splicers.
Okay,
they're
well,
drug addicts. Vicious animals.
For some reason, that one splicer, instead of coming out to fight me, just decided to close the door and that was it. So, what you got here, it counts as a weapon in that you have to slide through your inventory of weapons here in order to don this thing, but it's actually not a weapon, it's called a hack tool. And hacking is just sort of a little mini game you can do to sort of give you little tidbits of little advantages here and there. Like, for instance, you can use them to hack vending machines where you shop for med kits and Eve hypos and stuff like that. And if you hack them, and you know you beat the little mini game it takes in order to successfully hack them, then you know you can get those items at a cheaper price. And in this case, what we're going to do is hack this panel in order to open up the door that the splicer just tried to lock on me. And I kind of like that you do it in real time in this game. I mean, you just move that little needle around until, well, actually it moves on its own back and forth, I'm sorry, and you sort of choose when to stop it, and it has to be on the green in order to successfully hack it. Happens in real time, and it's much quicker than the hacking mini game of Bioshock 1, where you went to an entirely separate screen. You know, even if you were in combat at the time, you know, that would... You would totally leave all that. Everything else would go on hold while you played this mini game, and it was just a lot more tedious. You can also hack this thing, free health station. Now you don't actually need the hacking tool. Right? Oh, whoops. Let's take care of these guys first.
Fuck!
Now,
this is Dr.
The only
Sophia
plasmid I have right now is
Andrew
this
Ryan
electricity
dead,
I can shoot out of my hands.
But the tyrant dwells
now,
remember,
when you're, at least for me, when you're not facing too many splicers at once, just maybe one, two, three. If you hit, it's a good idea to hit them with the electro bolt so that they're stunned first. And if you walk up and melee them, it really does some extra damage. It's like hitting somebody while they're stunned. Kind of just, I you know, I guess the trauma that comes afterwards from whatever blunt weapon you're using, it sort of just sort of gives an extra knock. Then if you know, your blood's flowing, you're moving, and you get hit with that normally, probably wouldn't hurt as bad. That's just something I'm guessing. I mean, I've never been hit with an object while electrocuted before, so I wouldn't really be able to tell you the difference. It hasn't happened to me personally, and I hope I never experience it. Oh, but anyway, sorry, what I was saying. So you got this hacking tool right here. That's just for remote hacking if you actually can't reach the machine. But you don't need any particular item in order to just walk right up and hack it at close range. So if you hack this free health station, it costs less in order to just boost your health back up. $9, you know, pretty good deal. And it'll also give you a free first aid kit, so it's definitely worth it whenever you come across one. But of course, the little mini games will get harder and harder. Like, the needle will be moving faster. Either that, or it was, I think the main thing was that the safe spaces that you have to land the needle on in order to successfully hack, like the green and the blue spaces, they'll be narrower. It'll be harder to hit them. And they'll also have red spaces where if you hit those, not only will you fail to hack the machine, but some security drones will come out and be a big pain in your ass. They'll attack you for about 60 seconds. So this guy, Andrew Ryan, he was more... you know, you're going to hear a lot about him in Bioshock 2 in this game, but, you know, for those of you who played Bioshock 1, you know that he's already dead, and he was a bigger figure in that game. But for those of you who don't know, you know, this is the same Andrew Ryan I was talking about, the guy who started the idea for this whole city of Rapture in the first place. And, you know, naturally his selfish, self-serving, capitalist ideals definitely contradict with Sophia Lamb's. But you're going to get a little bit more of his history through audio diaries and stuff as people talk about him, even though he actually won't show up in this game in person. Hi, Sophia. Come on, get onto the screen. I'm waiting for you to notice that I'm still alive.
Symbol on your hand marks you a dead man. 10 years, Subject Delta, since I watched you put a gun to your head and pull the trigger.
You mean you made me do that?
Out of your pain, paradise was born. I don't know how you survived, but your suffering is over now. These men will ease your burden. Please understand that, like all I have done, this is an act of love.
And at the same time, while I understand her, she just manages to say things that are so twisted. Just like, you know, the most insane and ruthless of villains. Now the problem is, I kind of have to take this up the ass for a little bit. Yeah, before the bottom drops out and I'm safely in the water, away from the splicers.
Now you know of the enemy we share, Sophia Lem. The camera in your helmet allows me to watch through your eyes and help you to fight her.
Okay. So, emerging back in another section. How was my health restored again? Okay, well, I guess the game just kind of gave that to you for free, since you inevitably have to take that damage in order for the scene to progress. Or maybe water somehow eased the pain of the burns that Subject Delta was experiencing from the fire earlier. I don't know. Alright, so right here, and of course Bioshock fans will know this.
Careful. Security cameras belong to Lamb.
Security cameras.
If you are clever.
They hone in on you, and you don't get out of the way in time or hack it in time in order to kind of turn it over to your advantage. Well, then enemies are going to come out and harass you for a solid minute. And of course, you can lose a lot of health in that time, medkits and all. I mean, this is one of those games where ammo and health quickly come and go, you know? So that's why, you know, that's why there's extra health and ammo and other items on, you know, just about everywhere you can look, on corpses that are everywhere, in storage crates, really just about anywhere. This isn't like, say, classic Resident Evil or Silent Hill, where you pretty much conserve everything because, you know. Alright, so, we have three remote hacking darts here, so it'd be good to go ahead and use it here. Now the camera's on my side, and, you know, you'll know when you've successfully hacked it when the light on it turns green. And since there was a splicer there intending to use it against you, this time the camera honed in on her and put up these security drones right here that are flying around. You see harassing the splicer. You know, I could swear that. Okay, well. I could swear that the drone landed somewhere next to me, but I guess I was wrong. Might have just flown off after I killed the enemy because, well, there's nothing left for it to do. Yeah, that's what kind of effed up shit that Andrew Ryan had going on in this city. It's like, you know, there was... he was like a complete anarchist, but there was some form of law. I mean, for instance, you couldn't just... It was definitely against people, like, just literally taking stuff for themselves at no cost to everyone else. Because his, you know, sorry, at no cost to anyone else. I meant, like, you know, at no cost to themselves. Like, not in the way of business. Like, things like just straight up stealing, he was wholly against. So he actually installed these, you know, he actually made all these security bots that just fly around, and they will straight up machine gun you to death if you're caught taking anything, and especially if a camera sees you and summons them over to you. So I mean, there's just a lot of death going on in this city even before, you know, people started going crazy from Adam overdose and all that and became splicers, and just all out chaos erupted. But Andrew's main thing was, you know, the way the world above worked to him back when he still lived in it, you know, he saw it as he was against things like socialism. You know, he definitely didn't believe in, you know, free handouts. It's like his slogan was, you know, no gods here, only man. So basically, whatever man can do for himself, the sweat of his own brow, he's entitled to the fruits of that. And really, no one else has, you know, has any right to take it. So, you know, Roman Catholic Church, Christianity in general, religions, you know, starting charities, you know, people freely give to others in order to help them, well, that was not his thing. He called the recipients of freebies parasites.
It's me.
Didn't believe in paying taxes to the government.
I know you're awake in there. I can feel it.
So yeah, this is Eleanor.
To toy with you like that.
This is Eleanor, like, telecommunicating with me somehow, I guess.
You can use it now.
Somewhere along the way, our bond grew so strong that she is able to do that. Probably with the abilities also that her mother Sophia gave her through her experiments. Okay, so this is a new plasmid, our second one.
Throw objects at foes. You can even catch grenades and throw them back.
I wasn't a big fan of using telekinesis in battle. It's more of an out of battle ability. But it's to be able to, you know, take objects from far away. So lift them up and throw them out of your way. In case you have anything blocking your path. Oh yeah, and she scribbled out, "Hope this helps." Yeah, this is 10 years later, so Eleanor is like a teenage girl right now. She was a little girl in the introductory scene, of course, but so honestly, I don't understand why she still writes like this. I mean, she should be mature enough to do better. I mean, this is like, it's like multicolored chalk, and this looks like something a little kid would write. But actually, I mean, right as I was about to say that, I thought she'd probably have one of the little sisters do it for you. I mean, do it for her. Now I can take these and probably, if I drop it on a splicer's head, that might actually do some major damage. This is flammable gas, after all, in a compressed cylinder. Wow, I think that got all three of them that were down there. I'm glad I did that. Oh, you can also take other objects far away. Saved me a lot of work, quite frankly. Ah. There's a door we can, oh, I just came from here. Oh, I went up and around. I didn't even realize it. I'm an idiot. Actually, what's this? Hell, pneumo control? Maybe this sent something into this pneumo tube for me. Oh, it's just sending items out through here. I guess it was for me to work on my telekinesis plasmid in case I needed to practice using it. Just run around, collecting everything. If I'm going to try to go for a no-deaths run here, well, I definitely need all the help I can get. Oh! I do believe somebody is coming.
Sophia Lamb is using the splicers against you. Most Big Daddies are like her slaves, guarding the little ones. But someone has awakened you.
Well. I did say earlier and I was mistaken in a way, that there is no ammo you have to use for your initial weapon, the drill. But there is, for like an alternate attack with the drill, there is this. I mean, you need drill fuel in order to just, you know, go right up to a splicer and just start drilling into their torso. It's pretty much going to hold them in place. They're not going to be able to fight back, but of course it is costly because of the fuel. That's sort of the trade-off. But if you're fighting one one-on-one and you're just not in the mood to take any damage whatsoever, hey, you can go right up to them, just start drilling them in the face, and they're going to be pretty much helpless to do anything until a lot of their HP is sapped. Might as well grab all the Eve dispensers we can. Yep. Grab all the Eve hypos that we can from this dispenser is what I was trying to say. Okay. Might be some of these crates over here. I was wrong. Well, then we will just follow the yellow arrow, take this thing out. Of course, that gets the gears working in order to open this door.
I know of your bond with Elena Delta. To save yourself, you will come for her. But Elena has a destiny, one you cannot share. There is no place for you in paradise.
Well, thank you for basically telling me I suck so badly that I do not belong in heaven when I die. You're kind of a bitch. Yeah, some paradise you got going right now. Oh, I assume this means you meant that this was still a work in progress. Alright, audio diary.
In ethical psychiatry, we must account for the role of evolution. Depression, fits of panic, sexual pathos, all responses to ancient selection pressure. The irony is that this theory is why Ryan's people invited me here. They mistake my study of natural law for the worship of competition. Remember, Elena, one must know the beast before it can be slain.
Naturally, I'm sure she's going to try to convince Eleanor I am the beast. Alright, so here's our first vending machine. When we hack it, you can kind of see. When you land on the blue during your hack, you get that extra item, you know, first aid kit or ammo or something. But the main purpose is it costs less money to take things. I mean, to buy things. Certainly don't take. Andrew Ryan would not like that, even long after his death. This is a hint that I'm going the right way. Child's building blocks. Now, unfortunately, there's going to be a lot of enemies coming out here. It's probably going to be the first big battle.
Quickly, head for the elevator.
But no matter what, we should not let that camera see us. Not without hacking it. Okay, we'll, Whoa! Yeah, You know, kind of like in the heat of battle, it's really easy to forget about your health, and I like how they kind of give you that extra indication by Subject Delta making a particularly, you know, painful groan, and you'll kind of see blood splattering on the inside of his helmet. I just tried to hack the splicer. Yeah, that'll work. Okay, I think that's everybody. Go ahead and take our winnings. $9 is not worth that slight bit of healing. And I just got it back just by eating little food items here and there. That's one thing that I always thought was funny. I mean, I don't think it's genuinely like a legit criticism, but I do find it funny that, you know, you eat so much as, you know, the character you're playing in either Bioshock 1, 2, or Infinite. Infinite's the one that sucks, by the way. Please don't play it if you haven't already. And in fact, I made an entire video with Lantis a few years ago ranting about how badly it sucks. But yeah, it's like, you know, you'll just keep scarfing down, like, pieces of cake, bottles of wine, bags of potato chips, everywhere you go, and somehow you never explode from just this gluttonous rampage. It's just, you don't even really look to see what you're taking out of the storage crates in other places. It's, you know, you're just trying to restock your supply after a big fight, you know? So you're probably not even going to really look at what it is you're eating, but they just restore just little bits of health.
Now, here is what the children tell me. You are a very old Big Daddy, bonded for life to a single little one. When you are apart for too long, your body begins to shut down like a coma. As long as the girl is in the Rapture, you are trapped here as well. The name of your little one is Eleanor Lamb. Daughter of Sophia. She is kept at Fontaine Futuristics on the other side of the city. You must go there and save her before it is too late.
Pretty much before either of us dies. One dies, the other goes. But kind of the whole purpose is that your bond with Eleanor, despite you being, well, you were once a human being, but being essentially turned into a machine, despite that, you have somehow done this by choice. You prove that you're not a completely soulless, heartless monster that has no will of his own. Even though Dr. Lamb will pretty much try to sort of, you know, psych you out by suggesting things like that. Kit, that's good. And I think we're about to meet up with Lamb and have a gigantic battle. I'll go ahead and buy that. So, these things I just now picked up, you know, you see a few more on the floor overhead. Each gun also has, basically, alternative types of ammo. So, you got the normal rivet from your rivet gun here. It's like a spear, just going into somebody. And then you have what's called trap rivet. And I basically, you can use them as sort of just, you know, it's, I mean, you can kind of set up a security perimeter, you know, when you know that you're about to come across, you're about to fight a big battle, and splicers will just stupidly run into them, even though you can see them glowing half a mile away. They're just going to run into them and produce a big shock, and it will do major damage. So, what we're going to do here...
Here, in the ticket's booth. Press the button so we can speak face to face.
...is just kind of set up a few along the stairs, because some splicers are about to come out when I have this conversation with Tenenbaum. And also, let us see if... No, that's not going to work. I think if I had a remote hack tool, I could actually go ahead and take care of that camera from here. I really don't want to do it during the battle. And I know I'm going to end up, you know, I'm going to end up in front of that camera at some point if I don't turn over to my side at some point during the fight, just without even realizing it, because I'm going to be running around trying to dodge bullets and stuff. And it's going to get me, and it's going to add... It's just going to complicate the battle further. It turns out I had a remote hack dart. I found it at some point, and I didn't even realize it, so there was no need to buy that one. But it'll be totally worth it. Okay. And here is Tenenbaum. Boy, she really aged since the last game. It's only been about 11 years.
She is using the new little ones for something. And I have returned to rescue them. If I do not, more children will die for my sins.
Actually, no, I think just 1 year ago since the last game, at least from now.
Now, we must talk...
Citizens of Rapture, this is Subject Delta. Behind that
Hi, everybody.
Hides an enemy of the people.
Yeah, I'm Delta.
Without soul or sympathy. It is a beast apart. And as family, we must tear out its jaw and drive it back into the sea. Lem will take this place apart to fight you. Please hold back the splicers until we escape.
I really can't blame her for running away. I mean, she's not exactly capable of fighting. Okay. We can set up a few here. And we'll just sort of wait for them to... Yeah, if you get a good headshot right after you electrocute them, really does some extra damage. I mean, normally it'd take, like, you know, 8 or 9 normal shots in order to defeat a splicer right now from the rivet gun, but as you saw, a couple of shots to the head after electrocuting them, and... I don't know why I keep doing that. Just wasting a remote hack dart at him. Well, I was wrong. I can walk up here and make them take damage, I guess. You know, are there any security bots out right now even trying to... Oh, there you are. Here, let's hack one. No? Okay. Flew off.
Thank you. Now I must leave you, and I am sorry for this, but there are others I must help before the city drowns. This man Sinclair, he is an ally, and will guide you to Eleanor. Goodbye, Herr Delta. And good luck.
Yeah, I mean, when she says goodbye right here, she means it. And now we
well,
get this
look
interesting
at you,
fellow.
A bona fide knight in armor, complete with iron horse. The name's Augustus Sinclair Sport, Esquire. Old Tenenbaum and I share an interest in the old Fontaine building. the very same place you'll find Eleanor Lamb. I think you and I can do business. Take the train to Ryan Amusements. I'll see you shortly.
Yeah, so we're gonna meet Ben Sinclair in the next level. You know, he tells me straight up where Eleanor is being kept, and it's, you know, obstacles keep getting in your way, and that's what basically creates the game for us. I mean, there's five more places we have to visit in Rapture before we even get there. And the objectives I have to complete in each of them, it's probably definitely gonna take a lot longer than this particular stage. So, trust me, this... I know it might have sounded like it'd be a really short game, since that's my initial and end purpose, is to find Eleanor, but this is a decently sized game. Alright, let's go ahead and hack this, made by a couple of Eve hypos. There's some drill fuel, which I didn't need. I never actually used it, because there were so many guys around me at once. I don't want to kind of be a sitting duck. But one-on-one fights, they can be really good. Oh, I can also get a free health kit out of this station. Sometimes, I mean, they're so commonplace, there's actually more... It's actually more than one in the same area. Alright, guys. Well, I think that's a good place to stop off for this first episode. Kind of awkward on my commentary here, not gonna lie. I'm not able to really describe how, you know, the reasons why I like this game so much and, you know, how it moves me. I'm not able to do that very well. I don't know, when I get to actually trying to talk about it instead of just thinking about it to myself, but hopefully you will enjoy going along through this game with me, especially if your first time, this is your first time being introduced to Bioshock, so... And, you know, so far I'm enjoying this LP, so I hope you continue to watch. Thanks, I'll see you next time.